animators, artists, and students. The 24 Hours Animation Contest for Students is a free event which challenges students around the world to compete in teams of five to produce a 30-second animated film in just under 24 hours. Now in its 19th year, this challenge is hosted by animation professor Aubry Mintz, director of animation and visual effects at Chapman University. Welcome to the stream. Aubry, why don't we go around and introduce ourselves, starting with you. What is the 24 Hours Animation Contest, and tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, the 24 Hours Animation Contest is a concept I created in 2002 because I had a group of students that were not working hard enough. And so I challenged them to stay in the classroom for as long as I did. And I won't leave until the last person leaves. And out of a group of 25 students, five stayed behind. And like we went until I think 6 a.m. the next morning. And they produced more work in that, I think, 12-hour period than they had all semester. And so a light bulb went off in my head, and I realized students sometimes need a challenge, something that's outside of the classroom assignment. So that's really when 24 Hours was born, and that grew and expanded every year. It went from more teams to more schools to more countries, and now we're in about 15 countries with 1,500 students participating, and I think we're at about 120 schools that have participated in 24 hours. So it's just been this wonderful, fun, crazy thing that students seem to like. So we keep doing it.
And Brooke, how would you describe yourself and Bento Box Entertainment?
I am fun-loving. I'm an animator by training, who has switched over to the recruiting side and somewhat development side. My title is Head of Animation Talent Development at Bento Box Entertainment. Bento Box has three studios. I'm based in the LA studio, but I also help recruit talent for our Atlanta studio and our newly formed Australia studio, which happened during COVID. Bento Box doubled in size during COVID. Animation has never been so busy in its life on this planet, so that's amazing. And if you don't know our name, we make shows like Bob's Burgers, Paradise PD, Central Park, Great North, Duncanville, many shows that haven't seen the light of day yet, but that we've been working on, and they're really cool. Wolf Boy is one of our newest. That's for Apple Plus. So we've got a lot of things going on, and it's a really great atmosphere to work in. I'm very happy at Bento Box.
And we also have two champions from last year. Nikita, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and the film that you and Ame worked on last year?
So I'm a second year student at Sheridan, and our prompt was to discuss sort of how the pandemic affected your life. And we made it about these two kids who are friends. And at the beginning, they're sort of confused why they're brought apart because of all of the social distancing and everything. And then they find a way to sort of communicate, not directly, but through like windows and a little projector. And they sort of play with the same toys, but they're apart. So it's a little bit bittersweet.
And Ami, you mentioned earlier that this was not, like, last year was not the first year that you participated in the film contest. Can you tell us a little bit about your previous film?
Right. So I had participated in 2015 and 16 before I was a Sheridan student, back when I was a Berkeley student and doing art as a hobby because Berkeley did not have an animation major. So that was when I gathered a group of like-minded like hobbyists and other STEM majors who liked and enjoyed animation. And the two films I made at Berkeley were, one was Natural Selection. It was about a caveman who stumbles across like futuristic tech. And the other was Wallace. That was the year we had, the prompt was something about the concept of walls. And we just made a film where, what if all walls in the world disappeared? And it was, you know, a lot of like sight gags, like a guy's leaning against the wall and the wall's gone. of families arguing and the girl slams the door shut, but there's no wall to slam, so the door just falls over. Stuff like that.
And Aubry, I wanted to ask, you mentioned a little bit about how the 24 hours animation contest for students grew from a challenge that you ran out of a classroom. How did it become an international student film competition?
It's a good question, Mike. It was like very grassroots. It really started with students telling students, and you know, eventually colleagues of mine at my own institution, and then different schools. You know, at first it was, you know, within the CSU system, all the Cal State universities, and there's, you know, at least 8 of them that have animation programs. So that grew. But then when we went to social media and started spreading the news, more schools came on, you know, from, you know, across the US, different states, Canada. And then we had teams from Brazil, Czech Republic, Germany, India, Iran, Mexico, and it just kept blowing up. And we're seeing more this year as well. So it's just really cool to see how, you know, in fact, the pandemic became this way where students could find a place to unite and, you know, share their experiences. So I think that helped, you know, not necessarily with growth, but with, I don't know, the intent of the contest, you know, giving animation artists a space to kind of create without too many, you know, restrictions of assignments. And it just kind of, you know, the possibilities became endless. Yeah, so that's how it grew.
Yeah, so the 24 hours animation contest, for our viewers who have not participated previously, is based around 3 big constraints. One, projects have to be completed in no more than 24 hours. Finished film must be no longer than 30 seconds, and the films have to reflect a surprise theme. I want to go around and just ask how you feel that constraints can be helpful in creative projects. Aubry, what do you like about these constraints?
Well, for one, with only 24 hours, it's, you know, if you don't have too many constraints, you can do anything. And that's like a stopping point for so many artists. You know, that blank piece of paper, as Chuck Jones says, is like the biggest fear that many artists have. So, you know, having a topic at least that's not too refined and specific, general enough that people can have their own artistic exploration of it, at least gives some sort of confinement and limitation. But the rest is really up to them, how they produce it, what type of animation they use. The one rule is it all has to be created from scratch, so you can't come in with anything prepared. But it's amazing to see how inventive the students become, from doing, you know, even stop motion production to CG production, to like some really fun 2D production with effects. So it's wild.
Brooke, how do you feel about creativity and constraints?
I think constraints are really helpful for artists. It's just, I teach at CalArts at night too, and that's my alma mater. And it was always easier for me to create things when it wasn't just like, you can make anything, you know. In my class, we have time constraints for the films that we assign to our students. So it makes sure that they don't do something like epic and overly long that they won't end up finishing. I think 30 seconds for 24 hours, 30 seconds maximum is perfect. And it's nice to have a theme, because a theme is always like, you can kind of interpret it in so many ways, you know? So it still gives people a lot to think about and different directions to go in artistically, but it doesn't tie them down too much, and it doesn't make it so it's so open-ended. They're like, what do we do? What's everyone else going to do? You know, I think it just kind of helps with the anxiety of creating, because creating is wonderful, but it's also really hard.
Sometimes the scariest part of a project is looking at the blank canvas and sort of wondering, what am I going to do with this? So I want to ask, Ami, when you heard the theme last year, what was your first thought?
The first thought was, well, I should have seen that one coming. It's the one thing that has affected us most for that whole year. So when it became the theme, it's like, yeah, I probably should have seen this one coming. But at the same time, like, you know, after our whole team kind of sat down to think about it, we realized that because it's so recent and so relevant, we had like a whole pool of different experience and emotions to like pull from and basically concentrate it down into 30 seconds. And that's also why I think the constraint was so useful, because with 30 seconds, you have to make each second count and you have to have a very focused and like, you know, thoroughly thought out idea rather than, oh, I have, you know, 10 minutes to make a long epic with all sorts of characters and arcs.
And Nikita, how did you feel about the constraints on this project?
I kind of liked having them because we know that this is what the theme is, and you know you have 30 seconds to finish it, or you have 30 seconds to make. So you sort of have already your work set out for you. You just have to figure out what your film is going to be about. And that took us not too much time to figure out. And then we just got to work. We all did like boards together. So we knew we had 30 seconds. And then we went and we picked out what we thought was important. Like as Ami said, that you need every second to count. So we just picked out which was the best and we put it in and then we got it done.
Plus it evens out the playing field. Because if you have like, I don't know, if you remember in school, it was like group projects and some kids have like money and they can like build some big thing and, you know, make some video presentation or whatever. And then there was some kid who like maybe didn't have that and like they made something cool, but it's just like not fair. It's not a level playing ground. And I like a level playing ground for these kinds of things.
Aubry, I wanted to ask you, what do you feel that students get out of participating in the 24-hour contest? And not just prizes. Prizes are good too.
Well, the prizes this year are great, actually. They're going to be blown away once I announce it. Yeah, I mean, that's part of the reason I developed this, because there's only so much you can teach in a six-hour block when you're teaching class. So in most of that's focused on, you know, the fundamentals of art, animation, and such. But you don't always get to teach like the soft skills, you know, how to talk to each other, how to work in teams, how to know your strengths as an artist and your value as an artist. And so, you know, this contest allowed me to say, what are those things and how do I emphasize those and kind of put them on the teams to make them work together, to make them make limited, creative decisions under constraints, to see what's possible to do when you have just a small amount of time. It was kind of like replicating, you know, a crunch time or deadlines coming when you're in the studio system. Oftentimes people may have to work later or put in some extra, you know, really find their potential, dig deep. And this is that time where you're like, I've got 24 hours and I don't want to let my team down. So if I'm a background artist, I'm going to create the best darn backgrounds I can within my 24 hours here. So it's all those things that allowed it to be what it is.
And Brooke, as a recruiter, do you feel that participating in projects like the 24 hours contest shows something about the work that students can take on?
Heck yeah. I mean, I love anything that makes students finish something. You know, I know when I was a student and as a teacher, I see people not finishing things sometimes. It's like, cause you like try to take on too much sometimes and then like you don't finish it. It's just so much better to finish something, even if it isn't like what you wanted it to be. It doesn't, you know, meet the expectations. Just the fact that you like followed through on that says so much. And then as a recruiter, I'm always looking, you know, to film festivals like Ottawa just happened. I'm always watching, you know, the films that come out of this program and just always, 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 always looking for new talent. And, you know, there's recruiters all over the country and all over the world looking for talent. So this is a nice place for us to find people who are kind of up and coming and might have a voice or a style that we haven't seen before. That's always really exciting. Totally relevant.
Absolutely. Ami, what do you feel that you got out of the, was it three times that you've entered the contest?
I think what I got out of it was a lot of like team management skills, because I was always more of the like the spreadsheet pusher kind of person. But across all three, I started like developing a better system of how to work with folks, how to find like the strengths of my teammates, how to get everybody's opinion in while also like making sure the thing gets done, and just knowing how to delegate and manage relationships between artists, and also being really fast at animating and also animating quicker for myself.
And Nikita, what do you feel like you got out of your experience at the 24 hours contest?
I thought it was it was one of the first times that I worked on a project in school, like at school or during the school year. So it was probably my first project animation art related working with other people. And it was very
scare you off.
No. It was actually very exciting. And I like working with people. So I thought it was very fun that we got to work on this idea that we all liked and figure out what worked best with people. And I really liked doing the backgrounds and the character designs for it and kind of all like talking to the other teammates and asking them what they would like and them putting their input in. It was pretty fun.
I should say that, you know, this is a wonderful experience. Au revoir hands had collaborating together, and they obviously worked so well together. But I'll just say that it's not always the case. This is there's plenty of examples that I've witnessed firsthand where there's just breakdowns and, you know, people yelling, screaming, walking out, people like slamming doors. And, you know, that's part of the, you know, fun, I guess it would be. It's like, people realize that what do you do when you confront someone that doesn't share the same creative concepts or doesn't believe in time management or wants to focus too much on one scene and time, the clock is ticking. So, but even in those experiences, they're learning moments, and even those teams that have breakdowns, we've seen come back for more in another year after they're like regrouped and said, okay, we can do this. We've learned from our mistakes. Let's try again.
I like that it's not for a grade. It's like, it really separates the people who are in school who, you know, they may or may not end up doing this for a living, which is fine. Like maybe like a lot of people go to school and find out like, oh, and maybe I'm more of a fan of animation than I am someone who wants to create something that is so labor intensive. And like, that's all good. But this really does separate the people who want to actually get in there and do it. And it's, I mean, yeah, I guess there's prizes, but like you're doing it for the love of it, not grades or prizes.
Yeah, I think one big important part of it too is just not only creating work for external validation, but just creating work to create something really cool. Yeah. Nikita, I wanted to ask you and Ami about how you went about dividing tasks and figuring out how you were going to tackle the challenge.
Well, before we actually, like before we had the contest, we got together and we sort of discussed what our strengths, what our weaknesses are, and who wants to animate, who wants to do backgrounds, who wants to work on character designs. And we figured that all out beforehand. And then we also animated like a little scene to sort of test out who, like we came up, we like auto-generated a topic and then we practiced animating and coming up with something in like a really, really quick time span.
And yeah, it was nothing fancy. It was literally like, you know, each of us made like a 6-frame animation. It was scratchy. We only spent an hour on it, but it was, it really like became a little microcosm of what to expect going forward.
What was your topic? Do you remember?
We ended up, I think we auto-generated like angel lawyer. Was that it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I might use that this year.
Aubry, I wanted to ask, how can people follow the progress at the 24 hours contest? And is there any way, if they aren't participating, but just curious about how the teams are doing and what they produce?
Absolutely. So we have a Facebook group. It's Facebook.com/24hours contest. So anyone can join. And what happens every year is teams start posting like mad, and they'll post pictures of people all happy and excited at the beginning, pictures of people falling asleep and passing out under the table, and then pictures of people just trying to pull out their hair and, you know, coffee stains and pizza stains and trying to get it done. And videos too, we have a new prize called the Behind the Scenes Prize. So we're getting these teams to make like these mini documentaries, you know, 30 seconds to a minute. And we collect them and we watch them, and they're great for promotion, but we get to really see the insides of each team, and their personalities are just so wild. So yeah, the Facebook group, and then we do have an Instagram, Twitter, Discord, and TikTok this year. So
everywhere now,
covering all bases.
No Tumblr, no DeviantArt.
Oh, no. The Live Journal.
We were only Facebook for like 20 years. No. All right, next year.
Next year, MySpace.
Aubry, have you received any feedback from other schools and animation instructors about the 24 hours contest?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the best feedback is that they're joining and they're participating in more and more schools. You know, what I love about this contest is not only seeing the great work from each institution and how the teams work together and the variety of media they use, but also the schools we've never heard of before. You know, like there's schools in the Philippines this year, in Thailand, Taiwan, Hong Kong 1 year. So, you know, this is great tool for, you know, educators to talk, but it's also great for recruiters like Brooke to see who else is out there. 1 year, Rangsit University in Thailand won first prize, you know, beating out some of the big name schools like USC and CalArts. So you get these wonderful surprises as these smaller schools get spotlighted as well. So it's proof that it's been working for others.
There's definitely talent everywhere, and things like this contest helps us find it.
One thing I noticed too is that there are very talented artists and animators, as well as industry professionals and fantastic recruiters on the this year's panel of judges. Brooke, how did you get involved as a recruiter on this project? As a judge.
Aubry and I have been friends for years, and we're both on the ASIFA Hollywood Board of Directors. I'm currently a VP, but you know, those titles kind of revolve. And I wanted to sponsor this year through Bento Box. So we're helping to sponsor the contest. I'm very happy about that. Bento Box, everyone there was super happy about it. So you know, the animation community is so small, like we're all pretty close with each other, I feel like, you know. It's just, it's a wonderful community. I worked, as I was saying before this started, in visual effects and live action. And live action is such a bigger world, and it's a fun world. And then the VFX world was like a smaller part of that. But animation is just like, it's the best. I went to Kosovo during COVID for an animation festival and just met all these new animators there that I'd never heard of. I'd never thought of going to Kosovo. It was called the Anabar Animation Festival. It was amazing. But then like even there in Kosovo, this country I never thought I'd visit, there were still people who came to it that I knew. It's just how it is. It's the best.
You kind of bump into everybody everywhere. Aubry, I wanted to ask, aside from Brooke, who else is on the panel of judges?
Actually, Brooke is not a judge this year. She's just an amazing sponsor and
supporter. Okay.
Oh, I've got barking dogs. Sorry. But yes, we've just nailed down our list of judges. So we have, I will list them out now. This is the first time I'm saying them out loud. Alison, that dog will be a judge. As
the dog's opinionated.
Hold on. It's okay. Come here. Alison. Oh, sorry. This is the beauty of being at home. Okay, ask the next person. I'm going to put the dogs somewhere. Hold on 1 second.
Okay, go to another question. All right,
I'm going
to
go around. Brooke, do you have any advice for students who want to take part in the 24 hours challenge?
Yeah, sign up. You should do it. It's good practice. It's, you know, when you're, I don't know how every school handles student films at CalArts. most people make their own film, and they're like, it's not really a group project. We do some group projects. I know that some schools do only group projects, but this is a way to be involved in a group project and kind of like, there's no teacher telling you what to do. It's just like, there's no grade. There could be prize money, but you get to really be kind of more of an adult and a director, you know, and pick your topic together and iron out the story and, you know, decide who does what on the team. And it's such a worthwhile thing to do.
Aubry, do you want to go over the panel of judges?
Sure. Thank you. The dogs have been silenced. Not in a bad way. That came out wrong. The dogs are alive and well. But just... okay, so we have Alison Mann, manager and co-president of Fourth Wall Animation. We have Ira Owens, cinematographer for Sucker Punch Productions. Alan Hyun, director and story artist from that game company Netflix and Shadow Machine. Grace Babineau, background painter and color designer at Nickelodeon Titmouse Incorporated, Cartoon Network Bento Box.
Yeah.
Angela Abietti, character and prop designer lead for Nickelodeon Titmouse, Shadow Machine, Hot House, Avalanche Films. And Nathan Palm, Viz Dev artist and character designer from DreamWorks, Stupid Buddy, Shadow Machine, and Bento Box. And Ryan Stapleton, storyboard artist at 20th Century Fox Animation, Glenn Keane Productions, Netflix, DreamWorks, Nickelodeon, and Warner Brothers.
Superstar judges.
Good list.
All right. And Aubry, do you have any advice for students who want to take part in the 24 Hours Challenge? What are some things that tend to contribute to success?
I don't know how Ame and Nikita felt, but it seems like they were rearing to go, especially Ame, just like finding people at Berkeley. It was so exciting to see Berkeley participate, actually. I'm glad to see that you were helping to initiate that. But I think some students are really hesitant at first because it's really scary to think about how can I actually make, you know, 30 seconds of animation in 24 hours. That can easily take 3 to 4 months in the real world. So the best advice I can give is just jump in, you know, like you will learn something, whether it's what your strengths are, how to work in a team, or who knows, you may get a finished film in 24 hours, which is huge. So, you know, I think most students just, they get exhausted. It's brutal for a lot of it, but at the end of it, they wake up, you know, 48 hours later and they say, wow, I accomplished all that in such a short amount of time. And that's why we see a lot of these return participants, because it's like, well, this year I finished pencil tests. Maybe next year I'll do color. Maybe the year after we could actually win a prize. So just go for it, jump in and have fun.
And you know, 30 seconds is what, 720 frames of animation?
Yeah, exactly.
It's a lot.
It's a lot, but you have 5 people. So if you use that team well, you know, as these two have figured it out, you just find the strengths of each person and you work like this, where one person's storyboarding, the other one's designing. Another person is starting to do rough animation, the other one's doing rough layouts. And it just works like that. And you find that well-oiled machine eventually.
Ami, do you have any other secrets for success for participants in the 24 Hours Challenge?
Keep a spreadsheet. yeah, just, you know, plan everything ahead of time. Like, make a preliminary schedule beforehand. And give yourself like a ridiculous buffer, like maybe 6 hours buffer, because you will eat into those 6 hours. And then you basically have someone who have at least one person that's constantly keeping an eye on everyone's progress, because everyone's wearing a bunch of hats and we're all focused in on finishing our own part. But somebody has to be like, hey, did you finish background number 3 so I can actually start animating scene 2, and checking in with folks. And also just this kind of goes for everybody, like being kind to yourself during the contest. Like, it is okay if you're like, all right, I can't finish this background, because you're not in it for winning a prize. You're in it for the experience. I can't finish the background. I'm sorry. I'll leave it as line. I need to take a break for 2 minutes and I'm going to come back and, you know, revamp myself and keep going with the rest of the team. So knowing when to compromise and when to take breaks but also keeping track of how everything's going.
Which kind of happens on any film anyway.
Wait, sorry, two people were talking.
That kind of happens on every film anyway. Like something, you know, that's just, you're going to run out of time and something might be compromised or energy may have been put towards something else to make that better. So just, it's just good to get used to that.
Ami, the first thing that you mentioned was that you had a spreadsheet to organize your team. What did that spreadsheet look like?
I haven't. So basically it had like, imagine the columns. It had one column that had the name of whoever was assigned to it, a column for a time frame, like an estimated time frame, like 6 to 7 p.m., and then the task, which is storyboarding, like frames 1 to 3 on scene one, and then a status where we put check marks, and then a notes column where we put where things are like not going as planned, or hey, this, keep in mind that this is a problem. And you basically kind of go through, you add your name to whichever task you're doing, and you make sure you check off when you finish a task.
All right. And Nikita, what would you say that your suggestions would be for teams who are interested in entering the contest?
I think probably that you would be able to take a nap. Like, you don't have to work for 24 hours straight from start to finish and just like completely burn yourself out. If you plan it well enough beforehand, you would be able to maybe like lie down for like 2 hours or even just like 30 minutes, just take like a little open-eyed nap or something. Like, I think it's important to give yourself like time and be patient with yourself and be nice to yourself, as Ami said. I think that that would end up, you would end up with a much better product if you just take a little nap or just rest a teensy bit.
Aubry, do you feel there's anything that students in particular learned during the 24 hours contest that could be helpful to all of the other animation projects?
Yeah, really just seeing their potential when they just give themselves a strict deadline. You know, what can I do if I, like, in this contest, you're going to have to do a certain amount of scenes in a certain amount of hours. So you really test yourself. Okay, I literally have 1 hour to finish this scene. And those strong, strong deadlines and limitations force you to find your largest, you know, workflow and potential. So it's amazing. Once you unlock that, then, you know, when you go to your own film, you feel like you've had, you have like three times the amount of time, basically, to finish a scene, and you do it a lot faster.
Brooke, what do you feel like students get the most out of from this contest in terms of skills that they've learned that they can carry for the next projects?
I think there can be so many things. I mean, working on a team, like once you graduate and you're working in animation, it's just a collaborative medium and you're always going to be working with, you know, someone like Ame, who is, you know, the producer, basically, like the person who's got the spreadsheet for like the time and the budget. So there's that person is always going to be, you know, telling you where you're at with that. It gives them a chance to fail at something that, you know, isn't a high risk thing. It's not the end of the world if they didn't reach their goal on this. Like, you kind of feel like that is when you're making a thesis film or your final film for school. But this is kind of like a practice round. And you can also meet teammates, and even if they're not on your team, like people who worked on other teams that, you know, you're networking with, that you might want to hire each other. Like, say you get a show greenlit in the future and you're like, oh yeah, when I did that 24-hour festival a few years ago, there was this person who did this amazing background or whatever. Like, you're just, you could be finding people that work with you in the future. So there's so many things you can get out of it. And plus, it's just fun. Like, I don't know, this didn't exist when I was in school, and when I was in school, everything was on film or like crappy videotape. So I don't know how there, like, it would have been really hard to do something like this, like with so many schools internationally involved. So I love that about 2021. I don't love COVID, but I love the 24-hour film festival.
This would be a lot harder without the internet.
Yes, it would be very hard.
It would be impossible.
Yeah, I mean, you could do it like, you could do it, you know, locally and like screen answer prints together or something, but it would have been like, you know, within a city.
Send your post dated. Ame, I wanted to ask, what was it like attending animation school after you already had two productions under your belt?
Well, I guess the caveat being that my first year and my current year of animation school is probably not the norm. I am doing it all through Zoom, so that's not fun. But as I came in, and the thing is that folks here learn so quickly. Like, maybe I had a little bit of an advantage because I had done these two productions and people come in not knowing the pipeline at all. But by the end of the first semester, everybody's kind of caught up on the basics of animation and the pipeline. And if anything, like, the most interesting thing is just being surrounded by other artists. And whereas before, I think I was mostly, like, me and my friends, we were all just generalists. But coming in and seeing people who really specialize in viz dev and storyboarding and just being able to, like, I guess kind of like, you know, pick your classmate's brain to see, like, what makes this part of the pipeline so interesting.
And Nikita, was there anything that you felt that you really learned from your first year participating in the 24 hours contest?
I really liked being able to find out how long certain things take, especially when you're working with other people, because I know how long like a drawing or something would take for me on my own. But if I have people helping me out and going to them for like help or them coming to me, it makes it much more helpful and easier to do.
And Aubry, I wanted to ask, because this contest is so tied to like the joy of animation, what got you into this industry?
Oh, wow. Well, I grew up in Canada, you know, was always drawing as a young lad, Bugs Bunny and Mickey Mouse and stuff like that. And so once I realized you could actually study animation in college, I jumped to it. And the closest thing to me was Sheridan College in Canada. And so I learned the, you know, industry side of animation and the filmmaking side of animation. And, you know, my heart was in both. And so it just, all the possibilities happened. It was a good time because it's like the renaissance of animation had happened. All the great, you know, later Disney films came out and were so successful, Lion King, Aladdin, etc. And then this new thing at the time, computer animation was happening, like Toy Story, and gaming was taken off. So it was just a good time. And then I went into work in the industry as a computer animator on feature films and television. And, you know, I was hooked basically, and as well as independent production. You know, it's like something that Sheridan taught me about being a filmmaker is you could have this side where you're, you know, you're working in the industry and you're servicing other people, but then always keep this creative spirit alive and work on your own productions, which is something I still do. So, yep, I love it all.
And Brooke, what brought you into animation?
Well, my dad owned a model train store in Los Angeles when I was a kid. I'm an LA native, and so is my dad. And a lot of his customers worked at Hanna-Barbera and Disney, which were all close by, and Filmation. All the animation studios at that time pretty much were very close to where his store was in the Valley. And like most kids, I loved drawing and wanted, you know, like didn't know that that was something I could do for a living. And then these animators were like, oh yeah, you could totally learn this. And I said, how would I learn that? And they told me about CalArts. I remember one of them like taking just like a pad of paper from my dad's counter and like showing me what in-betweening was just on a pad of paper. I wish I had kept that pad of paper. and then, you know, cut to years later, I went to UC Santa Cruz, which I have the slug on my shirt today. For undergrad, and I was like, I still really want to learn animation. So I went to CalArts, and when I graduated, there wasn't a ton of work in 2D animation, and I did a lot of stop motion. So my first job was stop motion. I had been an intern at Nickelodeon on Hey Arnold, and I'm still friends with everyone from my internship. Like, they're still all in my life. They're still all working. So that's cool. That's many years later. And And like I said, I worked in visual effects for a long time because that was kind of booming at that moment, and worked on The Aviator and The Dark Knight and Inception and Hugo and The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen and some other not totally wonderful movies, but the jobs we did were really fun. We got to make large scale models and blow them up. And then the recession hit, and that really took a bite out of live action film budgets and visual effects budgets. So at that point I pitched myself to Cartoon Network and said, hey, I would love to switch over to the recruiting side, because I was doing some development work by that time at the VFX studio. And so I worked in recruiting and a little bit with development at Cartoon Network for years, and then bumped over to Disney for a while, and now to Bento Box. And like I said earlier, I love Bento Box. We're just growing like crazy, and I love our shows. And we just launched this thing called A Studio on TikTok. So we're doing like shorter form animation. So I get to find like more up and coming people who don't have experience for that. And then more seasoned people for some of our shows, and just get to have my hands in so many pies working at the studio. I really love it. That's as short as I can make that answer.
Brooke, since you mentioned that you have experience with model effects, I need to ask you, what is the most elaborate thing that you exploded?
That was the final explosion and inception of that big, like, snowy compound building. And we had money for two takes. So we did one round of explosions, and the first take was supposed to go like boom, 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 boom. And it kind of went boom, 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 boom. And then like the last thing didn't quite, it was like, ah! And then everyone on set was like, oh man, what are we going to do? Because then you only have one take left. So it took a week to turn the model around and like rebuild what's called like the purposely breakable parts. And but the second time they put GoPro cameras, were kind of new then, and they put the model makers put GoPro cameras all inside the model so we could see what it looked like blowing up from the inside too. And the second time they spared no expense on pyro effects. It was just like, so that studio doesn't exist any longer, but if you looked up New Deal Studios Inception Explosion, like something like that, I'm sure you would find it. It was really fun. I really love tactile things, and I grew up in a train store and I did stop motion, so I love that. But I also love 2D and CG. I love anything that artists can have their hands on and create and tell stories, you know, and do abstract things too. I like, you know, the range of experimental to commercial, like everything in between. So it's been a fun career, I will say. And we can nerd out later offline if you want to about visual effects.
Awesome. Ame, I wanted to ask you, what brought you from the sciences to animation?
Right. So I wouldn't say I was like a convert from one to the other. I've always had interest in both of them. And I think what really opened my eyes specifically to animation, because I come from the Bay Area, it's very tech, very science focused there. But what opened my eyes to animation was a summer I spent at CESA in CalArts doing the summer school program there, 2012, so almost a decade ago. And that's where I really saw, like, met people that did animation as a profession, found a community of people that are passionate about it. And even though at that point in my life, I chose to go to Berkeley, which was a bigger multidisciplinary school rather than a specialized art school, the experience kind of stuck with me. So even while I was studying biology, I was still doing a lot of like self-teaching for animation, made like clubs and like student-taught groups with like-minded friends who loved animation, and kind of kept that up. After I graduated, I worked in tech for a little bit, and I kind of realized, you know, like I do want to do animation like full time as a career. So now I'm here at Sheridan.
And Nikita, what brought you into animation?
So my family is from Russia, and every single summer, my grandparents would bring over Russian cartoons, like old Soviet cartoons, and I'd watch them for the entire summer because I'd be away from home, away from like the internet, away from anything. And growing up, I'd do this like every single summer. And then I was like, oh, I kind of want to make these. This would be fun to do as a job. And ever since like I watched them, I was like, I don't want to do anything but art and anything but animation. So then now I'm at Sheridan and I finally get to animate. Yay. So it's fun.
Do you have any recommendations for Soviet cartoons that we should look up after this discussion?
Well, there's a lot of great ones. I really like the Carlson one, like Carlson on the Roof. That's a great one. There's obviously the Winnie the Pooh one. That one's great. I love the backgrounds on it. Those two are probably my favorites, but there's so many good ones. There's like Hedgehog in the Fog, which is really gorgeous.
Aubry, we got a question in the chat for someone who's interested in connecting their school with this contest. Do you have any advice on how schools can join in, participate, get students involved?
Absolutely. Go to our Facebook group, which is Facebook.com/24hours contest, and you can post any question you want, message me or any of the 24 Hours team, and we'd be happy to show you the way to either register this year or next year, or just add you to the list of our educators. Which we keep in touch with. We also post to the Animation Educators Forum, which is Asifa Hollywood's Animation Educators Forum. It's a Google group, and you have to you know, be invited to get on the group, but once you're in, then you can see all the posts. And there's several educators from around the world that post regular jobs or opportunities. So it's a great group to be a part of.
Yeah, there's Asifa chapters all over the world. Aubry and I are directly involved in Asifa Hollywood, but there's Asifa International, and there's Asifa East if you're in New York, and there's Asifa South if you're more in like the Atlanta area, and there's one in the Midwest. So it's, if you're an educator or a student, and actually just to plug Asifa, we just lowered our student price for Asifa Hollywood. You can be a member for $20 a year. And we do a lot of, especially during COVID, normally our programming, you'd have to be here in LA to enjoy it, but because everything's online, we're doing a lot of panels and screenings online. So it's just a good, yeah, a good way to get
it. I want to ask you, I just wanted to ask you, what are some of the services that Asifa provides for artists and animators?
I know we have scholarships. And we have an animation aid foundation. Like if someone in the animation industry has gotten ill, we can sometimes, you know, give a little bit of money to help them. We've helped the Motion Picture Academy with some preservation. We do film preservation. We do a ton of things. I think the main thing we're known for are the Annie Awards, which are kind of like the Oscars, but just for animation. And they're for TV animation or streaming animation and feature animation. And there's all sorts of categories because, you know, at the Oscars and the Emmys, there's kind of a limit to how many categories can go to animation, which makes sense because they have so much to cover. But the Annie Awards happen every year in February or March. And it's just a night where we celebrate all of animation. So it's definitely worthwhile. And then we do, in normal times, we do mixers for members just so they can meet each other and connect, because that's a big way of how you can get work in the industry and just meet cool people because animators are the best. So Asifa Hollywood, or I don't
know.
Meet
people that you haven't seen since you were in Kosovo.
What's that? What was that?
You can meet people that you haven't seen since you were in Kosovo.
I know, Kosovo. If you get a chance to go to the Anabar Animation Festival in Kosovo someday, it is simply amazing, and it's a really beautiful country. I had no idea, so highly recommend it.
Aubry, one of the restrictions with the 24-hour animation contest is that the films have to be in under 30 seconds and in duration. Do you have any advice for telling a story in just 30 seconds?
You know, it's that old adage, keep it simple, stupid. Just super, super simple, like one tiny log line, very few characters, you know, few backgrounds, maybe like five or six scenes at most. Don't overthink it, you know, just one character arc or one simple point you're trying to make, and build your story around that. Even the animation doesn't have to be super sophisticated. You know, it's really just about getting that story across. Like, it can be a glorified animatic with some color and some slight movement. If you start there, and then, you know, if an animator has inspiration at midnight or two in the morning and wants to flourish a scene, great. But ultimately, it's just get it out there, get your scenes done, and export before deadline. You know, if a film comes in at 31 seconds, it's disqualified. And if a film comes in at 4:01 p.m. instead of 4 p.m., it's disqualified. So it's important to export early. And even if it's not your finished, at least you have a film to send in, and you can always replace it later.
Brooke, do you have any insight on telling a story in just 30 seconds?
Yeah, I grew up watching commercials on television. Commercials back in the day were 30 seconds. It's so funny. I was on vacation last week and we were in a hotel and they had cable, and I haven't had cable in a long time. I was like, wow, commercials. But, you know, there's a lot of great commercials. There was an animator back in the day named Bob Abel who did these beautiful award-winning commercials. Like, look up Robert Abel if you're interested in seeing some cool old commercials. But that's a place where a lot of animators have, especially independent animators, have been able to make a living in the past, is animating commercials. And those are 30 seconds for the most part. So you can say a lot in 30 seconds. You can get a joke in or a point across or something poignant and moving. You know, as the old saying, besides Aubry's old saying, there's also the saying less is more. So sometimes I see films in festivals or as an instructor and I think, gosh, I wish they'd made this a little bit shorter, you know? And I know that when I watch my old films, sometimes I'm like, why didn't I edit that out? It would have been better if I had made it shorter. So 30 seconds is a bona fide amount of time to tell some kind of story and to make an audience feel something, which is, you know, the goal of films, is to provide some kind of emotional journey for an audience member.
Tommy, how did you approach telling a story in just 60 seconds or 30 seconds?
Well, a lot, like, it's already been covered that at the end of the day, simple is better. But there, I don't think there's been a single time where the original, like, verbal pitch wasn't cut down a ton by the time we got to the storyboard stage. Even when we thought, like, the original pitch is, that's simple enough, we can do that in 30 seconds. By the time we started boarding it out, it's like, oh, well, this is might be 45 seconds. So basically, just, I think it's going to be inevitable that cuts are going to happen. It's just knowing what to leave on the cutting room floor and making sure that you actually, even if it's stuck together, like, even if it's like a timer and somebody pressing next on a slideshow, to have some sort of like time-based animatic of your rough boards to actually see, is this 30 seconds? Does this part feel too long? And can we remove more?
And Nikita, is there anything else that you want to add about telling a story in a very short amount of time?
Well, I think there's a lot of stuff that you can just, like, you can say different things in like a smaller amount of like time. So we have this one shot in our film where the two children go in, like, are taken into their homes by their parents, and then you're like on the street, but then it pans up and you're at their windows, like they're both at their windows, and it becomes nighttime. So this period of time where they're going upstairs, going out of their window, like looking out their window, the daytime changes to night, it all happens within like maybe 2 seconds. So you sort of like cut down all of this stuff, but you have all of this stuff still happening.
Yeah, we also had a segment where we had a transition from the park to the house. And like, maybe in the original picture, we're like, oh yeah, we have to show the parents picking up the kids, taking them out of the park, and then opening the door. Like, none of that is important to the story at all. I think we just ended up going with a straight, like, flash to white cut to the house. as long as you can make the mental connection that cut is in a different location, then it worked fine.
Speaking of telling a story in a very limited amount of time, we are almost out of time. Aubry, how can people learn more about the 24 hours animation contest for students?
Go to the Facebook group, 24 hours, Facebook / 24 hours contest. We're also on Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, and Discord. So you'll find us. And there's a link tree. So once you have that link tree, which is just, I'm just learning what a link tree is this year. Basically, a link you click on that has different links to all of our sites. So once you get there, you can find us and all of our handles and how to register and all that. So join us. You've got literally till 11:59 tonight to register your team. So get in there.
And Brooke, where can people learn more about Bento Box and see some of your work?
Oh, go to Bento Box ENT, like Bento Box Entertainment. But so it's bentoboxent.com, and you can learn about the studio, and we have all of our jobs posted there. And we're so busy right now that I swear we add new jobs every week. It's just bananas. So everyone out there, I just want you to know that you are graduating or in school or studying animation at the very best time in the history of planet Earth to know the art of animation and have those skills, because there is just so much work out there. So hooray for you. Aubry and I saw more ups and downs in the industry, and the downs were not that fun, but I mean, I would still say, like, save your money for rainy days. But it's a really, really exciting time to be working in animation, or to be an animation student, or just doing animation for fun. Like, maybe this isn't going to be your career, but it's just a beautiful art form, and it's limitless. So we look to you to create the next wave of cool animation in the world.
And Ame, where can people find more of your work online?
Well, I have some social media that's not super active anymore. I do have, my portfolio website is, it's just Amelia, TSAI, my last name, .com. And that's my current portfolio website. And I think my socials are also linked there. So that's where you can probably find most of my, more professional work.
And Nikita, where can people see more of your work?
So I have a Instagram and a Twitter, also a portfolio website, but it's linked on my socials. So my Instagram's hedgehog at a garden party. Every single space is a underscore. And my Twitter is just garden hedgehog, one word.
Aww. For Yuri. Cool.
Thank you. Thank you to everybody for joining us for this panel discussion about the 24 hours animation contest for students. If there are any students watching this, you can get discounted student licenses for Harmony and Storyboard Pro at toonboom.com/students. Wow. And if you would like to try Harmony or Storyboard Pro, you can find 21-day trials at toonboom.com. Thank you again for watching, and tune in next time.
Thank you. Thank you, Toon Boom. We use Toon Boom all the time at Bento Box, FYI. Love it.
Toon Boom's amazing.
It is.
Two Toon Boom.